Other than friends, what are the nice things about growing old? I'm growing to my age. I'm now called a senior citizen. And one of the nice things about this is that people will come up to you and say, so what was it like at the beginning? And you say, I'll tell you. So when Ms. Yadav contacted me and said, would I be willing to speak about how the CHS started in the early days of JNU, I said, yes, certainly I'll speak. And I've had a lovely 2 weeks of thinking about it, jotting down ideas, things, memories coming back. And all I want to say is that the other aspect of growing old is that one tends to romanticize the past. And I'm always accused by my younger friends when I talk about the early days in JNU, or they say, but you're romanticizing it. Yes, of course I'm romanticizing it. That's what life is all about. You go on romanticizing your experiences and that keeps you going. So anyway, let me begin by apologizing for what you may think is a romanticization of the Center for Historical Studies in the early years of JNU, but which I think is actually a very accurate account. I joined JNU in November 1970. That's almost 50 years ago. And I was among the first few appointed. We started teaching in 1971, so we had time to prepare syllabi, courses, and the pattern of teaching. I came from Delhi University, where I had taught in the history department for 7 years. And I left there because the courses had been drawn up some 30 years earlier, and changing these, even tinkering with them, had become problematic. The focus there was on political and diplomatic history, quite legitimate, but with minimal attention to other aspects of the past. History was for them a narrative of elite activities. But history as a discipline had begun to change with new methods of analyzing sources and a much wider range of explanations of what happened in the past and why it happened. History was in fact undergoing a metamorphosis. And I think that those of us that lived in those years were really very privileged, because the metamorphosis was very, very intellectually exciting. History was undergoing a metamorphosis from being a subject in Indology, providing very useful information, to becoming a discipline in the social sciences. And I thought, therefore, that JNU might provide an opportunity to work with a new approach to history. In the later 1960s, which is the kind of background for discussion in the university, this new history was taking shape. It was being extensively discussed elsewhere in the world, although in India it was still discussed only by a handful. This was the time of the great teachings associated with the Dialectics of Liberation Conference in London in 1967, and similar events in universities in France and the United States. New ideas emerged from wide-ranging debates, as also some protests about what was being taught and how it was being. A less audible echo of this could be heard at Delhi and Calcutta University and a few other places, but only at the edges. Nevertheless, This was the time of optimism and the coming of a better world, as we all thought. Theories explaining the historical basis of societies were taking on a new legitimacy. There was immense interest in the challenges of contesting theories and the insistence on free discussion. Debates ranged over ideas emanating from Marxists, anti-Marxists, neo-Marxists, extending to other theories that were later to evolve into postmodernism and still later post-colonialism and the literary term. Whatever might have been the intellectual stance of participant, pro or anti-current theories, it was not just sloganeering, except occasionally. It was rooted in reading and thinking about what was being discussed. And this was the intellectual ambience when JNU was founded. Arguments in Parliament, however, focused on the ideas of the man after coming to the university in Zane. The founding Vice Chancellor was G. Parthasarathy, known to everybody as GP. And although his career had been in diplomacy rather than academia, he turned out to be a better VC than many academics that we have known. Vice Chancellors in India, as we all know, have to be very carefully chosen, as they can make or break a university. GP was a liberal and well aware of what makes a fine university. In the exploring of knowledge and ideas, and through teaching and research, and also a concern with the welfare of students and faculty. For him, JNU had to be a university of quality, a pathbreaker in the pursuit of knowledge, and bringing this knowledge to students from every segment of Indian society. And to achieve this, he asserted the autonomy of the university and was not dictated to by the ministry. The support of academic opinion mattered more to him than that of politicians or bureaucrats. A university, after all, is not a pakshala. Since we were starting from scratch, we needed time to work out courses and syllabi. And so we were given a few months off to do this and to recruit more faculty. The initial faculty of the CHS consisted of Professors Satish Chandra, Sarvepalli Gopal, Bipin Chandra, and myself. Our specializations covered the range of Indian history, and we recruited other faculty. Satish left shortly after to become chairman of the University Lands Commission. It needs to be said that if Bipin Chandra brought in a radical element, and I'm using radical in the old-fashioned meaning of those times, not if he brought in a radical element, Sarvepalli Gopal was the quintessential liberal. And the combination of the two invested the CHS with the appropriate ambience. The insistence that we address each other by our first names did not eliminate the sense of hierarchy, but it did noticeably reduce it. It was a relatively small faculty, and discussions on what was to be taught became a manageable exercise. Our courses were not a repetition of the MA history courses of any other university. They were interdisciplinary, adding to the quality of our discipline. And GP, to his credit, made no attempt to control whom we recruited, nor what we taught, and who brought what. We had complete independence as professional academics and full professional responsibility level. This, of course, is essential to the intellectual life of any university. We were concerned with teaching courses that would enhance the understanding of Indian society as a whole. I have competition. Imitating courses from the best universities in the West, some still colonial in their orientation, was not how we saw the new history. There was, for instance, an ongoing debate between the CHS and what was referred to as the Cambridge School on the interpretation of the colonial period. Sensitivity to the world around us led to an effort to teach courses that raised issues around questions of social inequality, control of resources, categories of labor, all essential aspects of understanding the structure of society and how it changed, and also the cultural patterns that emerged. Our effort was to create an independent space for thinking and producing new knowledge, making research a primary activity. The semester system encouraged smaller courses that would focus on concepts that were central. That were central, self-contained, and could be completed in a semester. The insistence on tutorials as a system of evaluation was necessary to the kind of history that we were teaching. The requirement of reading for a tutorial, writing the essay, and discussing it formally was an innovation in methods of teaching at Indian universities. It also brought about a greater communication between the tutor and the student. However, given our hierarchical society, the implicit hierarchy did not disappear. These methods of teaching can fail if student numbers are arbitrarily increased without other adequate support, such as parallel increase in faculty and in the availability of books. The quality of education is what suffers the most. The tutorial system also became a link between student and teacher and tutor, sometimes with a kind of curious aside. One of my experiences, if I may relate it, a student whom I got to know through tutorials came and talked to me one day about an emotional problem that she had. And we eventually thought and agreed that she should see a psychiatrist. So I asked around and an appointment was made with a psychiatrist at AIMS. And she insisted that I go with her. So this I did for a few times, three or four times, then I stopped. Why did I stop? Because a friend of mine from AIDS rang me up and said, you know, there is much talk in the psychiatry ward as to what is wrong with Professor Thapa that she keeps coming repeatedly to consult the psychiatrist. So I'm afraid that kind of puts conclusion to that relationship. This system of tutorials and exams was dependent on the availability of recommended books in the library. This the faculty had to ensure. And I remember that we all rushed around in our spare time from Old Delhi to Gurgaon to buy books and preferably to look for private libraries that we could acquire. And we did acquire one such, which was the library of Gigi Kosambi. The bonus in this case, of course, was that we got to read some of his rather acerbic and amusing comments which were scribbled in the margins of the book. There was initially a debate on internal assessment at the MA level. Our courses were different from other universities and taught in a manner that was unfamiliar to faculty elsewhere. Nevertheless, it was agreed that external examiners may ensure rigor, but ultimately it was decided to keep the evaluation internal at the NAA. The faculty would be required to maintain the recognized standards because the reputation of the university depended on the quality of students that were given its degrees. Inevitably, there were sometimes small differences of opinion on grades, but by and large, it worked well. Mechanisms of redressal came into use and continue to be used. The reverse procedure of student evaluation of the teacher has never taken root in Indian institutions, and perhaps for obvious reasons. For a guru to be evaluated by a shishya would require turning the Indian mindset upside down. The admission policy of JNU was discussed at length. There were arguments over having a written entrance exam, an interview, the number of deprivation points for various categories of people, and so on. Contentions over admission policy or other aspects of university administration took the form of occasional gerows of the VC or the chairperson of the center. The gerow of the VC had other uses, and indeed also of the center. Sometimes we volunteered to sit in on the gerow together with the VC because it became the occasion for a chairperson to have long, uninterrupted dialogue with the VC on the problems of the center concerned, the kinds of dialogues that we wouldn't have otherwise. In the case of the chairperson, I do recall one such gear where I was involved, and that finished up with my doing a kind of extended tutorial discussion with some of those who were heroing me. We have to engage with the idea that when students are taught to think independently, they will protest about many things. The two go together. Protests need to be talked to. The university needs to have all its component parts participating in this conversation. Such discussions sometimes took place in the classroom or in open meetings. And I always think it's a pity that there are not more teach-ins on campuses, as they can be a useful form of extracurricular conversations on a variety of questions. The contention over admissions led to the introduction of the entrance exam together with an interview. Many exam centers were set up, and JNU drew students from an all-India range, unlike most other universities that tended to be more parochial. This enhanced the national character of JNU. Our system of deprivation points brought in students from social classes that normally do not get admission to university. First-generation learners from lesser-known colleges mingled with those from metropolitan backgrounds. Some were from the humanities stream and some from science. And so we had to devise a syllabus that would convey to them not only a sense of what history was all about, but also train them to think in a manner which is often described as a critical inquiry. Asking questions is vital, and one has to learn how to ask questions that might yield answers. Widening the catchment area brought in student interests pertaining to their own regions. This inevitably broadened the geographical scope of research. Similarly, the diversity of social backgrounds also alerted us to the need for expanding the themes that we included, and more so at the entry level. For those that had some difficulties in following analytical methods, we worked out a one-year catch-up course on language training and methodology. Any student from whatever background or college or university wishing to be better prepared could take this course prior to the two-year MA. But the students rejected the idea, arguing that they could not extend the MA for another year, even if given a grant to do so. This problem has been at the crux of many others over the years and has intensified in recent times. It needs to be seriously reconsidered, certainly by JNU, if not other universities. The MA consisted of 16 courses, mostly in history and some in associated social science disciplines, to be taught over 2 years. There was an additional language course, other than in the student's mother tongue, and chosen to relate to the textual sources he or she may be required to use. This was debated at great length, as some thought it might be just a burden on the student. It was thought to be more difficult for medieval and ancient history students, because they would have to learn classical language, Persian and Sanskrit. But some of us felt that a working knowledge of Sanskrit, for example, was essential for students studying ancient India. And in those years, the JNU was the only university in India where this became compulsory. We were fortunate in having a linguist in the CHS who specialized in both Dravidian and Indo-Aryan linguistics and taught both Sanskrit and Tamil. Of the 16 courses, we decided that 4 of these would be compulsory for all students. These would be the courses in which we would focus on 2 aspects of history, namely the methods of research and the interpretation of. The assumption was that all social sciences have a method of investigation, especially for research. In history, the purpose is to get information from the past, but also to explain what happened in the past and why. This means recognizing and analyzing the possible range of sources and checking their reliability as a first step. The next equally important step is to ask questions of the sources in order to explain what happened in the past. Existing knowledge gets to be checked and is having advanced in many, in various ways. We thought comparative history would be a help, not just as a source of information on other societies, but in seeing how historical concepts are used in their study. Were such analyses relevant to our history? The 4 compulsory courses were historical method, ancient society, feudalism, and capitalism and colonialism. These 4 courses were the most innovative in our syllabus and were in SPAC. They were unheard of in other universities until recently. The maximum brainstorming went into fashioning these courses. These early years were intellectually the most stimulating for us as faculty, since they forced us to think critically about what we were intending to teach and how we were going to justify courses that were so different from the usual. The brainstorming in the CHS was occasionally acrimonious, but generally quite meaningful. with differences usually being ironed out through much discussion. This was possibly because there was amongst us at that time a strong sense of a shared social commitment, underlying both what we were teaching and in the stance that most of us took on public issues. And my goodness, there were plenty of public issues, given that history is the chosen battlefield for what is described these days as extreme religious nationalism. Kind friends from Delhi University teased us about the new syllabus, declaring that we would never get any bright students, since why would they waste their time on such way-out courses? Yet, not only were our students excited by our courses, which they found to be different, and in many ways more relevant to their understanding of the past, but we also noticed that slowly and slowly, some of these courses were finding their way into the syllabuses of other universities. There was a time when it was said that historians were trying to discover the truth about the past. This claim is rarely made these days. The truth about the past cannot be known by any method because the past has disappeared and cannot be reconstructed or conjured up. What we are concerned with now is how to explain what happened in the past by using the sources at our disposal. And this is why the causal links that we make in order to explain the past should draw on well-reasoned and logical connections. The final statement, if based on a cogent explanation, becomes that much more firm. But should some new knowledge come our way, then the narrative and the explanation might have to change. Let me illustrate this from my specialization in ancient history. When the history of India was first written in modern terms in the early 19th century by the likes of James Mill and others, there was virtually no knowledge about a certain emperor called Ashoka Maurya, since little or nothing is said about him in Brahmanical sources. Only some Buddhist texts refer to him, and these at the time received little attention. So for over 10 centuries, he was unknown to Indians. But when a body of inscriptions were deciphered in 1837, there was mention of a king who referred to himself as Devanampiya. But no such king is mentioned in the Brahmanical texts. His identity was suggested when the Sinhala Buddhist texts were studied in the late 19th century, and these referred to an Indian king, Ashoka, with this title. It was only in 1915 that an inscription was discovered which refers to Devanampiyasa Asokasa. The king's identity was thus revealed and Mauryan history changed. So one never knows where a new fruit may appear. But let me return to our four compulsory courses. The search was not merely to use new sources to expand the narrative about the past, but also to provide new ways of correlating and analyzing evidence. The other three of the four compulsory courses focused not on single societies, but on the various concepts that are used in different times and places. It is recognized that societies register social disparity, and we took this as an entry point to the past. Societies were governed by chiefs or clans, or by kings claiming to be of the upper caste. The city-state of Sparta had a separate society of slaves, the Helots, who lived as families, separate from free citizens city. This form can be contrasted with Garst and with those that lived inside the settlement and with those that lived outside the settlement. The question to be asked is, what were the alternate organizations and how did they function? Did this have an impact on other patterns of culture? And comparative studies can be helpful in sharpening definitions and discovering new theories of explanation. In many societies of the world, the period prior to the Mong is described as medieval. This is taken as a time when the social and economic structure is thought of as based on a feudal pattern. The course on feudalism, therefore, discussed this concept and its varied applications. These latter are immense, as is now being recognized, and the extensive Indian subcontinent had its own varieties. Again, comparative studies are helpful in understanding whether there was a particular kind of Indian feudalism, or more than one, and how the forms differed. The focus is more on land as a resource as compared to earlier times. Many questions arise, such as, who controls this resource? Who labors on it to make it productive? And ultimately, who profits from its productivity? And what is the associated cultural pattern? There is the juxtaposition of this activity with the forms taken by the cultural patterns that it supports. The third of these courses, that on capitalism and colonialism, highlighted modern times. The intent here was to show the interface between the two, both in the colony and in the home country of the colonizer. British colonialism provided a clear example, although comparative studies of other patterns of colonialism were included. These were taken from European colonial control of other parts of the world. The degree to which this fostered capitalist development has to be ascertained. The interface between capitalism and colonialism has not always been sufficiently recognized, even by those who have worked out detailed theories of explanation, as for example in the writings of Max Weber. Does the type of colonialism affect the way in which capitalism advances in a particular society, as in the colonies? Can this be contrasted with societies that have not been colonies in the literal sense? These four courses were what we call the core courses. In a sense, they set out the concepts and concerns around which history was being debated in our times. This was made clear by showing how these societies were studied in the previous century and why they came to be studied differently. Readings had to be up to date, and this forced students to have some idea of current debates in other histories. They provided a glimpse into other areas and pointed out the need to see different societies reacting to historical change. Historical change that was partially similar and partially dissimilar. Coming to grips with the concepts basic to this course prepared students to handle problems emerging from a range of historical situations. Or so we hoped. Having these rather open-ended courses meant that the next person teaching the course in the years to come could introduce other societies for comparison, provided the focus remained on concepts. Since these courses were newly configured, we realized that some students would find it difficult initially to understand them. We were particular, therefore, in announcing at the start of the course that job was, that any student who wanted a further explanation of the topic, or who had problems with the explanations, or disagreed, was free to interrupt the lecture and the discussion would follow. I recall one such occasion. I was giving a lecture in history in the course on historical method, and I was speaking on historical fallacies in history. Halfway through, a student got up and began to read a Bengali translation of the Little Red Book. Now it's Little Red Book. Both the class and I were perplexed. Now, after a few minutes, he closed the book and sat down. So I asked him to explain what he had read, because not all of us understood what they were. So he explained it as best he could. And this was then followed by the liveliest of discussions, with both agreement and disagreement, and the discussion went on for over an hour. Every student present had strong opinions on the subject, for and against the definition of what is a historical fallacy. This was, I must admit, one of my most successful classes, not because it began from a particular book, but because every student had argued vehemently. Many years later, I was told that each of those students in that class had subsequently held forth with confidence in disputing the definition of a historical fallacy. The emphasis was very much on a readiness to discuss. This was so not only in the lecture room, but also outside. And gradually it extended to topics of contemporary interest, when faculty and other outside speakers were invited to speak elsewhere on campus, and vigorous opinions were not only expressed, but debated. As is generally agreed, the university is a place that by rights should have freedom of speech and free debate. And we wanted this to be effectively so in JNE. Theories of explanation in history are varied and many. Marx's periodization of history had a more orderly and precise series of historical explanation than those, for example, of Max Weber. And these were the two great theorists of historical explanation that we discussed at that time. We discussed both and others and made our choices. We were aware of the concept of modes of production, not as explanations of Indian history, but as a useful starting point to ask questions about causation and historical change in the context of larger debates. Our concern was not with proving them absolutely right or absolutely wrong, but with using them to trigger questions. Much was said, and is still being said, about JNU being Marxist in its orientation, and especially the CHS of those days. Such a comment fails to see that all non-frivolous theories of explanation have to be assessed for viability and therefore have to be prized apart. This does not necessarily mean an acceptance or a rejection of the theory. It does mean an assessment, and that is what determines acceptance or not. Testing the application of the theory can become a form of asking questions. I might add that one of the outcomes of teaching these courses was that they triggered off a widespread debate on the meaning of these concepts used and the explanations they provided and their application to Indian history. This debate by then was not restricted to JNU but was current in other institutions as it had been earlier. For example, Many Marxist historians argued in support of a feudal law in Indian history, but it was also a number of Marxist historians, some from JNU, who questioned this law as applied to India. Marxists and anti-Marxists of every hue had opinions on this debate, and it went on for a few years. It was actually extremely useful to the study of medieval history. Regional history came into focus, since much of the evidence comes from sources of regional history. Studies ranged from varieties of tenancies to differing patterns of caste relations. The variations led to an interest among historians in aspects of environmental history, socioeconomic history, administrative history, and cultural history. Medieval history, earlier regarded as the Dark Age, was now illumined by information and analysis. This debate has been a significant departure in the study of pre-modern Indian history. Of the remaining 12 courses, three were the choice of the student. These could be courses in non-Indian history or in other disciplines of the social sciences. Modern history students tended to study aspects of sociology and economics. Those working on pre-modern periods were encouraged to read social and cultural anthropology. And our sociologist colleague in the CHS was a valuable asset, although there were others in the school as well whose courses were taken. The remaining nine courses focused on a broad period of Indian history. We debated in great detail whether we should follow the period, the conventional periodization of ancient, medieval, and modern. Historically, it was defective, since the breaks did not mark any major historical change, only a change in the religion of some of the dynasties in the 12th century AD. We were also well aware of the overlaps between one and the other. What stopped us from changing the periodization in the syllabus was that most advertisements for teaching jobs in history specify one of these periods. Therefore, if we had discontinued with them, our students would have had problems finding jobs. So, we continued with the three, but underlined continuities and overlaps where needed. The specialization then was in one of these three periods. In each, there was a set of core courses that taught students how to examine particular aspects of the history of that period. Political, economic, social, religious, cultural, and their interrelations. And the interrelations were very important. These courses required students to be familiar with primary sources and the different kinds of sources relevant to each theme. The remaining four were optional courses on other aspects of the same theory. The intention of this course structure was that the student should acquire a good idea of the historical context and background of the period studied, have some comprehension of the concepts that are used in historical analysis, and be familiar with the method of analyzing the past and understanding what is meant when it is said that history explains the past. Methods of analysis such as these can be meaningful to research in almost any subject. Let me now mention some critical reactions. Criticism came from a few Marxists for an insufficiency of theory in our courses. Our response was that theory was a means of understanding the past, that the focus could not be singular, and assessing the agenda of sources and other such aspects had also to be considered. At the other extreme was some conservative and even some liberal opinion arguing that our history was far too theoretical. We were faced with reactions opposed to each other. These became even more intriguing when we discovered that some of our most vehement critics were including courses similar to ours in their syllabus. Historical explanations made greater sense where they drew from logical and secular explanations. This we saw as the contribution of the CHS. It was a time when the teaching of history explored little beyond political and religious factors, and that too generally at a rather superficial level. Even those that claimed to be writing history from an indigenous perspective, whatever that means, were actually basing themselves on colonial meanings. Our critique was of the colonial versions of Indian history, subjecting them to a secular and reasoned analysis. This became an alternative, if not a corrective, to the colonial reading of the past, a reading that nurtured, in some ways, in many ways, a defective history and provided a justification, for example, for the extreme religious nationalisms. We had and continue to have our share of confrontations with fantasy pretending to be history. It is as well to remember that from the late 1960s, Indian history was shifting from Indology, particularly Creole Indian history, from Indology and being inducted into the social sciences. In this mutation, the role of the CHS was not insignificant, and indeed the role of other centers of historical research as well. These were pioneering efforts that have had an impact in many areas of historical studies over the last half century. One is not looking for clones, since that was not the intention, but new courses in some universities do reflect this change, in part because some of our students are teaching there, but more because it has become an intrinsic change in the definition of what is history. History as a social science becomes an intersection of knowledge that inevitably has an impact on many disciplines. And in many ways, the history of any discipline is its starting point. I have been speaking of how the CHS started and its early life. People have come and gone, and much has changed in GMU and inevitably in the CHS. I retired 25 years ago, so I can be accused of being nostalgic about the early years, and I unashamedly am. But I believe that much of what we started continues, and hopefully the foundations that we helped to build will not be overturned in coming years, no matter how severe the pounding may be. What the future holds is hard to predict. One is only too aware that the social sciences are at a risk of being diluted, to put it politely, and especially in the better universities, where they have been pushing the intellectual frontiers. Dismantling any one of the three, whether it is the humanities, the sciences, or the social sciences, will of course wreck the system of knowledge, since the three are interdependent. It does not require much intelligence to recognize that advances in the sciences come from exercising a critical inquiry into existing knowledge. And this is often motivated by the questions posed in the social sciences. In every branch of knowledge, it is critical in inquiry that is at the root, whether we trace our thoughts back to Socrates or the Buddha. And knowledge in every field has to keep up with advances, otherwise it becomes extinct. To know the past of Jain is in part to remind ourselves that the university was created to advance knowledge and to make this accessible to all those qualified to use it. This involves questioning existing knowledge and being able to seek answers to the questions in a free and unfettered manner. Knowledge is the heritage that we leave for those that will come after us. It has, therefore, to be cultivated and nurtured even against odds. That was our mandate, and hopefully it will remain foundational to this institution. Thank you.